Hey guys, Jake from 8020 Media here. Today we're going to be talking about common problems and reliability of GM's 5.3-liter EcoTec3 engine, which inevitably means that we're going to spend a lot of time talking about active and dynamic fuel management. The 5.3 EcoTec3 was released in 2014, replacing the fourth generation 5.3 Vortec, and is still in production today. There have been a few different engine variations that have been used throughout the past 10 plus years. The most common ones are the L83, which is the 5.3 EcoTec3 that has active fuel management. There is also the L82, which is one that features AFM, but is used slightly less. And then we have the L84, which is the 2019 plus variant that has dynamic fuel management, which, as we'll talk about here in a bit, has some different considerations, problems, and functions very differently than the L82 and L83 with active fuel management. Before we jump into talking about AFM and DFM, let's go ahead and talk about a couple of the smaller problems that these engines have. These are not quite as common. They're not potentially catastrophic or expensive to fix. And so I'm just gonna tick through this list a little bit more quickly. So these are direct injected engines. And so with that, naturally, a common problem that occurs in these is carbon buildup. In addition to that, you also have, you know, your spark plugs and your ignition coils that need to be replaced more frequently. And then as you start to get to very high mileage, that's when you'll likely start to run into some issues with fuel pumps and things like that, as well as potential issues with the fuel injectors too, just due to the direct injected nature of these vehicles. Outside of that, once you get around the 100,000 mile mark or so, these engines tend to develop an issue with oil consumption. And in addition to that, the only real other thing I have to cover is the 8-speed transmission on these vehicles. The 8-speed transmission has a ton of complaints. It's known to prematurely fail sometimes at 100,000 or even before 100,000 miles. It also has a lot of complaints with just hard shifting and overall just having a rougher feel and not being as smooth as you would like your transmission to be. Now, some of these transmission issues were fixed. GM started using a different transmission fluid and that fixed a lot of the problems, but the 8-speed transmissions, generally speaking, are a lot less favorable than both the 6-speed and the 10-speed transmissions. One thing that I'll note now is that the 2019 model year tends to be the worst model year for these engines. In addition to having significantly higher rate of DFM-related issues, it also had a number of other general issues going on with it, just because it was a new engine variation and it was the first year that it was used. If you really want a winner, there were a number of vehicles that were produced in 2021 and early 2022 that did not have DFM because of chip shortages from COVID. And so there are some out there that you can find that don't have the software for DFM. They do still have the hardware though. But I will say, because those systems don't have the software, the likelihood of running into a hardware issue is significantly lower. So now that we've got that covered, let's go ahead and talk about AFM, DFM, the differences between the two, and what the problems look like for the EcoTec3 engines. So, as I mentioned, there are a few different variations of this 5.3 liter. Two of them have AFM. The newer one has DFM. And so AFM was predominantly used from 2014 until 2019. And then in 2019, some of the higher trim models and eventually in 2020 onwards, all started getting dynamic fuel management. The big difference between the two is active fuel management can only shut off 4 cylinders at a time. And so your V8 5.3 liter can run as a V4, and there's only 4 specific cylinders that can be shut off. And each of those 4 cylinders has the AFM specific lifters on them. This is important because part of the issue with lifter failures on these isn't just because of the AFM or DFM systems themselves, it's because of the actual design of the lifters too. The design does tend to be problematic, and so AFM is both a software and a hardware issue as well. Now, when we look at DFM, DFM basically took AFM and expanded on it profoundly. Now, all 8 of your cylinders have the DFM specific lifters on them, which are problematic, and any one of those 8 cylinders can be shut off. and there are 17 different firing combinations or variations of cylinder patterns that can be turned on or off. And in addition to that, your V8 can now run as a V3, a V4, a V5, V6, V7. And so there's a lot of different combinations. Ultimately, it's a lot more complex of a system. When we separate these two, AFM is problematic, but AFM, generally speaking, doesn't tend to be as big of a problem until you get to the higher mileage levels. I would say by the time you get to 150 plus thousand miles on any AFM car, you're probably experiencing some type of lift or tick, and you will eventually or have a high likelihood of running into lifter failure at the higher mileages. But now when we look at DFM, DFM is a more complicated system, and we've also just doubled the number of cylinders that have the bad lifters that can be problematic. And so when you just think about that, we now have twice as many components that can potentially fail. And rather than having a system that purely cuts from V8 to V4 mode and only four specific cylinders, you have a system that's cutting from V8 to V3 to V6 to V5. And ultimately, that, in my opinion, it makes sense that DFM has significantly more problems than AFM does. The moral of my story here is that the DFM engines suffer lifter failure more frequently, and I would say at significantly lower mileage levels than you experience on the AFM side. Now, I don't want to make it seem like AFM and DFM are absolute problems that you're going to experience. I would say the failure rate is still relatively low on these. Most people would probably estimate it on the high end to be around 1% or potentially even less than 1% of the vehicles. But I would say that's probably the failure rate on vehicles on the newer end, but you also have to consider that GM is making millions of these vehicles every year. While the failure rate is relatively low, there are a lot of trucks out there that inevitably are going to experience these issues. As we look at AFM and DFM, the best thing that you can do is try to mitigate the issues that come from these systems. And that's extremely important when we consider the fact that running into lifter failure on either of these engines is going to result in anywhere from $3,000 to $5,000 to $10,000 of repairs. It gets very expensive when you do run into an issue with AFM and DFM. Because of that, and because of how common of an issue it is, it's important to try to prevent those issues as much as you can. Now, like I mentioned, part of the issue here is a hardware related issue. The AFM and DFM lifters themselves are probably designed as well as they can be, but they are just naturally problematic. But another problem here is the software, and especially how frequently the software is used. I'd have to check the numbers again, but I want to say on AFM vehicles, AFM is activated somewhere around low 50% of the time. And then on the DFM vehicles, DFM is activated 60 plus percent of the time. So if you think about that, 60 plus percent of the time, your engine's not a V8 and it's running in who knows what engine mode. Ultimately, the only way to really 100% prevent these issues is to do a full-on AFM or DFM delete, which requires you tearing into the engine, replacing the lifters, and doing a bunch of other work to basically take AFM and DFM out of the vehicles. That's great to do if your lifters have already failed. If not, though, you're looking at a very expensive project. Our recommendation for any engine with AFM or DFM is to install a AFM or DFM disabler. We have our own one of those right here. This is our Boost AFM and DFM disabler. This will keep your 5.3 in V8 mode 100% of the time. I can't sit here and honestly tell you that you're never going to experience lifter failure with this because, as I mentioned, there is the hardware component of it as well. But I can promise you that this will significantly reduce the likelihood of you running into lifter-related issues now or down the road, regardless of what mileage you're at. So if you have a 5.3, this is a $150 product that could potentially save you from a $5,000 to $10,000 repair bill. So it's absolutely worth it from a peace of mind standpoint, as well as from a preventative problem standpoint. Our device is 100% manufactured in the United States. We pride ourselves on that. And we truly believe that this is the best and the best value device on the market. You can buy this on Amazon or on our website at boostafmdisabler.com. I'm not just trying to push our product here. This is genuinely something that I would recommend to have on any EcoTec 3 engine. The only one caveat is that we do not currently have a device that supports the 10-speed transmissions. That is something that we're currently working on since all of the newer vehicles are being developed with 10-speed transmissions. So we should have one for those coming out sometime here in the near future. Let's go ahead and recap all of the things that I've discussed here. To make things easy, outside of AFM and DFM, these engines are very strong and very reliable. There's not any major issues or concerns with them. If we look at AFM and DFM, since all of these engines have them, AFM strongly preferred over DFM. The problem is that you can't find a 2019 or 2020 plus vehicle that has AFM in it since they switched over to DFM at that time. And so if you want AFM, you're limited to the older models. And then when it comes to transmissions, the 6-speed or the 10-speed transmission are a lot better than the 8-speed transmission. Anyways, guys, if I were gonna tell you how to take a 5.3 EcoTec 3 and make it as bulletproof as you can, my first recommendation is gonna be getting one of our Boost AFM disablers. The second thing is going to be installing a catch can. The catch can will help with the carbon buildup issues that you run into and can also help prevent issues with your fuel injectors down the line. And then thirdly, what I would do is change your oil every 5,000 miles. All these cars are now coming out with the intelligent oil life monitoring, and you might not change your oil until every 7,500 or even 10,000 miles on some of these trucks. Regardless of what your oil life monitor tells you, change your oil every 5,000 miles, and that will significantly, again, reduce the likelihood that you run into issues with AFM, DFM, and lifter failure. All right, guys, well, that wraps it up for my video on the 5.3 EcoTec 3. If you appreciate this video, please click the like button, subscribe to the channel, and stay tuned for our future videos.